The Incredible Adventure of Alvin Tatlock. Alvin Tatlock lived an unremarkable life in an unremarkable house with an unremarkable job. Alvin Tatlock always did what was expected of him and stuck close to a strict trajectory in life, as most do. Boarding school, university, graduate work. And then... work, 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 stretching out like clockwork to the end of his days, which became ironically appropriate. For Alvin Tatlock turned aside from the path laid by his studies and began repairing clocks for a living. He found comfort in the order and regularity, but also felt as empty as the sound of a clock counting off the hours to an empty room. Monday through Friday, the same routine, wearing him down, day after day, week after week, year after year. Saturdays were for chores and errands. But Sundays? Ah, Sundays were reserved for the one bit of frivolity in Alvin Tadlock's life, a trip to Yost's secondhand bookshop. Alvin loved books, particularly secondhand books. The spine was already broken in, the pages moved more easily, and they smelled divine. And they held the promise of learning whatever he set his mind to, as something his day-to-day severely lacked. Sometimes, if he was very lucky, he could find an inscription inside the front cover. No matter the subject, those were his favorite. Someone, somewhere, had taken a great deal of time selecting this particular gift to give to another person. And that other person had simply given it away. Or lost it. Or died. Alvin liked to pretend that these messages were really for him and him alone. And that these books were really recommendations from old friends and dear family. Alvin devoured those books, filling his mind, expanding his mind and giving him something to look forward to. And so he continued in the same monotonous rhythm for years, nose to the grindstone or a book, life ticking by, steady and unchanged. Till one day, while browsing through the classics, he happened upon a book that quite literally turned over a new leaf in the life of Alvin Tatlock. The Clock, the Key, and Where They Led by Dalton Pike. There, a photograph in black and white of the kind made by some antiquated camera of a bygone era, though the subject's clothing appeared to be far more recent. A man, seated, with a girl, perched precariously on his knee. A boy sitting on the floor in front of them, playing with a brass pocket watch. The girl appeared to be engrossed in the same book that Alvin was now holding. There, scribbled in cursive, the Pikes 1933. Alvin was intrigued, to say the least. Quickly, quickly, he flew to the front of the book, hoping to find an inscription. And there, in the same hurried handwriting as on the photograph,
to my dearest Gertie, never fear quarrels, but always seek hazardous adventures.
A quotation Alvin recognized immediately as
Alexander Dumas.
A curious Alvin wondered aloud,
what sort of book is this?
Excuse me.
What?
Yes, I'm sorry, that's my book.
What?
Yes, I'm sorry, that is my book. Do you see the inscription there?
Yes, from the Three Musketeers.
Oh, stop, say that again.
Yes, from the Three Musketeers.
Good Lord, are you American?
Yes.
Well, what are you doing here?
In the shop.
In England.
Oh, Well, I wanted a good education, and Oxford seemed like
stop,
a clear
choice. Stop. It's so dreadfully boring. I'm terribly sorry. That is my book. The inscription there. To my dearest Gertie. That's me. Ooh! And that's me, too. Oh, I was adorable. Oh, I'm sorry. Where are my manners? You are?
Alvin.
Alvin, last name?
Why?
Alvin, why?
No, Alvin Tadlock.
Oh, Alvin Tadlock. Yes, that is better. Gertie Pike, adventurer and dilettante.
Dilettante? So you do a lot of things, but none of them particularly well? Like mid-level management?
Oh, is that what that means?
Yes.
You know, I always just like the sound of it, but it's a good thing it's entirely appropriate. So yes, Gertie Pike, adventurer and dilettante.
Oh! Well, does that pay well?
No, but thankfully I'm filthy rich. Old money, but not stuck up, you know. Lots of fancy parties with small foods, but I sneak them out of my bag.
Do you make it a habit of using words you don't know the meaning of?
Oh, yes, it's my version of wordplay.
Oh. Well, aren't you afraid that you're going to embarrass yourself?
No, you see, a third of people don't know the meaning of these interesting words, so they'll just play along pretending that they do. And another third of people wouldn't dream of corrupting your polite society.
And the final third?
Well, they'll tell you the definition that you've learned the word with minimal work. Anyway, my book. Oh, I'm sorry, are you all right?
You said a lot of things very quickly, I'm processing it.
Yeah, my book.
All right.
Thank you.
Wait. How do I know it's yours?
Well, the inscription.
Oh, maybe you saw this book earlier. Maybe you saw it, and now seeing it with somebody else makes you want it even more.
Oh, good Lord, man. It is a book, not some lousy housewife flirting with the best maid. No. I'm terribly sorry. I do not have time for this.
Okay, you can borrow it. And she was off, out of the shop and down the street. Alvin considered allowing this brief encounter to become a strange interlude that he told as an anecdote at obligatory fancy parties and small foods, but there was something different in all this, and Alvin found that he liked it. Well, most of it.
Wait! Wait! Why is that book so important?
Why do you want to know?
Well, I don't know, but I do.
Oi! Give me that book!
My God! A man with a gun!
What had Alvin gotten himself into?
Remain cool.
Why?
That is not cool.
That's not an answer.
Hand it over. I've got just as much right as you, Gary.
Oh, my God!
Suddenly, a constable happened by on patrol.
Officer, that man has a gun and bad intentions.
Damn it, Gary!
And so, thanks to Gertie's quick thinking, the police were closing in.
Follow me!
What?
Run!
Alvin followed Gertie down a side street. His heart was pounding, but what he felt wasn't exactly fear. Well, there was a little fear. Mostly fear. But now with something completely different.
Maybe scared. Are you going to tell me what this is all about?
Why do you want to know?
You dragged me into this!
You followed me!
You stole my book!
My book?
I'm still not convinced of that. Get back here!
He really should stop announcing himself like that.
Oh, he got away!
He got away?
It's all right, follow me!
What?
Keep running!
And that's exactly what Alvin did. He followed the strange adventurer and middle-management-esque dilettante. He ran as though his life depended upon it, because in that moment it very much seemed to. Then, after several twists and more than a few turns, they ran into a train station.
Sorry! Excuse me, pardon me, sorry!
Activity in the air. Oh. But with the train pulling away and the man with a gun behind him, ducked down deep and found a new personal best.
Come on, you can catch it!
Bang! 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 Oh. Bang!
Is he shooting?
It definitely appears so.
This isn't over! I will find you! Both of you!
That was close.
What the hell was that?
Just deep breaths in and out.
We should go to the police.
No, police ask questions.
What, running from men with guns?
Running in general.
Do you do it often?
More than the average man.
You're a very strange woman.
Thank you. All right. In and out. Isn't that better?
Yes.
A nice flush about the cheeks. I think a jog here and there might suit your constitution.
Alvin hated to admit it, but he did feel slightly revitalized. As the train pulled to a stop, Gertie jumped down and into the crowd.
Oh, I'm so very terribly sorry.
Wait, sorry. Wait!
Mr. Tadlock, I think you will find that you are free from harming to be on your merry way.
But I have questions.
And I have business to attend.
No, hang on just a second. Well, my day was going just fine until you barged in here with your adventuring and dilettantism.
Yes. Well, now I'm barging out.
Well, you can't do that.
Says who?
The polite society.
Oh, good lord, we mustn't offend polite society, must we?
I don't like your sarcasm.
Guess what? I don't like your suit.
What's wrong with my suit?
Oh, nothing. I just wanted to hurt you.
Are you going to tell me why this book is so important?
Get rid of Arabella Pike!
Alvin looked up and realized he was standing in front of a once beautiful, now decayed townhouse, in front of which stood an imposing woman. Who also fit that description?
Good lord, what's this?
This is an Alvin.
Where are we?
We're at one of my many safe houses.
This is not a safe house!
Aren't you, Gina? You promised me.
Yes,
this is not a touch on you. Yes, we're at one of my many safe houses. I've got them all over the city.
Why do you need a safe house?
I know, hiding, that sort of thing. All adventurers need safe houses.
That's what. Get inside! We do not hold private conversations on the street! For heaven's sake, we are not Italian!
Quite right, Auntie Eugenia. A thousand apologies.
Gertrude! Don't be so submissive. It's tiresome. Bring me American inside.
Oh, no, I don't want to intrude.
Inside.
All right.
And then enter the home of Eugenia Jacinta Pike's Stroud Hargraves, covered with dust, and dimly glowing with antique gas. The house, not Eugenia.
Gertrude, what did I say about pursuing your father's inane family legacy?
Not to.
Then why did you defy me?
Because I'm 30 and you're agoraphobic.
I'm not agoraphobic. I simply can't allow the puppet to see me at my current weight.
You see, she had once been the most beautiful star of the silent screen. Clearly, she was no longer. However, it had made her fabulously wealthy. In a tidbit from which you will benefit, but that we haven't the time to go into with any great detail, Eugenia Jacinta Pike's Straub Hargraves had been married to several men who tried to take that vast fortune. This led to a general distrust of their whole sex, with the exception of her closest companion and cockatoo, San Sebastian.
San Sebastian, I need you! Please, come to me, my beautiful. What do you want with my niece?
Nothing.
You mean to tell me you did not try to seduce my niece, my dearest living relative, growing ever closer to her, making her trust you? Or so that you might profit from her gentle naivete?
Naivete?
Well, she's hardly naive, and that would be very difficult in the 20 minutes that I've known her.
But not impossible. Oh, I missed it.
Drop it. No. You leave poor Alvin alone.
Just pick me up.
I know. He's had quite a difficult day.
And I still have no explanation.
It begins with my father.
What?
And why not?
Because you have no sense of how to properly deliver a story. I shall tell it. So, Sebastian, prepare my lap!
Oh, no.
Recovering, San Sebastian flew off to the lighting booth at the top of the house, as Eugenia Jacinta Pike's Straub Hargraves then prepared to do what she did best. Perform.
Help me up. Sit. You must now use your imagination to travel back
hundreds of years to the fertile peasant.
Eugene and Jacinta Pike's Glowpargrades then launched into the most incredible of tales. It was brilliant. It was riveting. It was 2 hours long, no intermission. So let's save some time, shall we? Eugenia told Alvin of the story of the Library of Alexandria. For those uninformed, it was a library in Alexandria, in ancient Egypt, that held a vast store of the knowledge of the ancient world. Until, during Caesar's siege of the city...
Et tu, Brute!
It was accidentally burnt to ruins.
Forget the children! Save the scrolls!
It had been thought that all of its knowledge had been lost. That is, until Sir Dalton Pike...
Hello.
Gertie's father found a small bit of evidence that a small cache of scrolls and codices had been spared from the inferno. He quietly dedicated his life to their pursuit. Until he became ill. Right. And we could find a way to pass on the tradition to Gertie whilst keeping it hidden from the world. Then, having devised an ingenious plan to do just that, he died.
Goodbye. Will?
Will what?
Applaud! I was magnificent!
Any questions?
Several.
Proceed.
Who was the man who was chasing us, and how does he know about the book?
That was my brother.
Cass. Well, he was shooting at us. He was shooting at you.
Scandalous, isn't it?
You see, Father always had a bad habit of playing favorites.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, don't be. I was the favorite. No, it's just because of that we've always had a bit of a sibling rivalry.
That is putting it mildly.
Oh, really? How would you put it?
It's the equivalent of a familial blitzkrieg.
Yes,
my beautiful boy.
Gertie had indeed been the apple of Dalton Pike's eye. Kellan had tried to win his father's favor, but nothing swayed. Then, as is so often the case with neglected children, he resorted to bad behavior to try and garner some attention. However, this only led to further division.
Well, your brother can't be all that bad.
He squandered his share of the family fortune.
Well, but people make mistakes.
On gambling.
Well, that's not good.
With my ex-husband.
No.
Yes. And after he ran out of that money, he stole the offering box from the church.
No.
Yes. Money that was meant for orphans.
Yes. Some people just aren't redeemable.
You know what they say. God gives us relatives.
But thank God he can choose our friends wisely.
Correct. And one loyal friend is worth 1,000 relatives.
Ahem.
Present company excluded.
Socrates.
Euripides.
I was close.
That book you are holding is Gertie's inheritance, a last surviving family heirloom.
My father wrote it. My father was a brilliant writer and adventurer.
Much like his daughter.
Oh, you write?
I doubt it.
Oh. Cut the key and where they led. Well, aren't there more copies?
Yes, but this one is different than any other you'd find in a shop. This one is special. This one is mine. Let her open up.
Office.
Thank you. Now, when my father passed away, I was abroad. But there is a fantastic story as to why I have this book.
Well, she was abroad, but I...
Yes, actually now she's a lady.
Oh,
my goodness, yes. Well, I donated the book because I knew my grubby little nephew, Keller, would tear the house apart looking for it.
Yes, my father wrote this book and riddled it with clues. Clues that he would hope that I could help you to find the Library of Alexandria.
What's that?
This is the map.
Oh, no, it can't be.
Perhaps Perhaps you'll allow me to prove it.
How?
Come with.
Why?
What else have you to do, Mr. Tatlock?
Did he want to leave? How could a lover of books refuse such a literal call to action?
Well, I don't think I'm suited, and I do work tomorrow, and... Bam!
What was that?
It's your brother. He's trying to shoot the front door lock.
How did he even know I was here?
I'm your only other living relation. This wasn't exactly the most clever of safe houses.
No, but it was the closest.
What do we do? Upstairs. Get to the roof of the next townhouse and climb down. I'll deal with my dear nephew. Don't argue. Just go. I'll be fine. And you, go with her. I shan't have my niece sent to this task alone. Promise.
Well, I...
Time is of the essence.
I promise, yes.
Good. Go. Saint Sebastian! Get them help! Fanfare! Fly, my pretty! Fly! Fly!
Eugenia just into Pike's shroud Hargraves, then grabbed her harpoon and her candelabra and prepared to defend her niece, her home, and their family legacy.
Ready or not, here I come!
Alvin and Gertie climbed to the roof, across to the next townhouse, and down again, hook in hand, once again on the streets.
Where do we go?
I don't know.
Well, how close behind do you think he is?
I don't know.
But what do we do?
My answer is unchanged.
Just then, an elegant townhouse to a halt beside them, containing a somber-looking Russian.
Vlad?
Здравствуйте.
Gesundheit.
Hello.
Vlad, what are you doing here?
Persuasive bird.
Oh, Saint Sebastian.
Ah, da. Madame Eugenia, tell bird you need help. Bird, tell me.
Thank you, Vlad.
It's nothing. Anything for Madame Eugenia.
You see, Vlad had an unrequited love for Madame Eugenia. Jacinta, Pike, Stroud, Hargraves. As we will not have time later, let us jump to the end of their story. Due to her distrust of men, she made Vlad wait patiently and respectfully until she at last agreed to be his wife at the age of 92. They shared a blissful 6 hours together until Eugenia Jacinta Pike Straub Hargraves Vasiliev shuffled off this mortal coil, followed 2 hours later by her Vladimir. They were buried side by side, and people still say that they have never seen more names on a single headstone.
Come on, let's go!
I don't think I should.
Oh, you can't stay here. Come on!
Alvin then went for the most terrifying car ride of his life!
Besides, don't you have a job to get back to?
But I...
What?
Well, I don't think I should leave you on your own.
Do you think me incapable?
No, I didn't say that.
Are you blind?
That's not at all what I meant.
Well, what did you mean?
I only meant to say that it seems rather dangerous.
Well, you would be in the exact same amount of danger.
Well, yes, I realize that, but that's...
Spit it out, Mr. Tapper!
Well, then I promise! I promised your Aunt Virginia.
I won't take. Besides, you don't seem quite cut out for this.
Well, hear me, but... I want to see this through.
All right, you convinced me.
Oh, good. Where do we start?
The map. Let's have a look at that.
Oh, yes.
All right.
Well, it's just scribbles and nonsense. It doesn't make any sense. How does it work?
I don't know.
Well, didn't your father leave you with any instructions?
Not really, no, just that.
Well, then how are we supposed to read it?
I'm not sure. I don't know, Alvin. I don't know. But that's part of the fun adventuring. The puzzle and the chess. So let's think. No, still doesn't make any sense.
No. Well, we could use an expert in toponymy.
Ooh, good word. Toponymy. Toponymy. Oh, that really works in diction.
You don't know what it means, do you?
No. But context clues tells me it has something to do with maps.
It's the study of place names, origins, meanings, that sort of thing.
So not
maps? No, but it's a start. An old professor of mine, Merton Smithy from Oxford, happens to be an expert.
In toponymy?
Yes, that. We happen to be very close by.
Excellent, well then let's go.
Where are we going?
I don't know.
It's this way. Alvin and Gertie were then off in the direction of Oxford. Professor Merton Smithy was one of the foremost scholars of toponymy. It is rather fun to say, isn't it? Toponymy, toponymy, toponymy. One of the foremost scholars of toponymy in all of England. Now, I should like to say that this was common knowledge, that his vast intellect had garnered him some measure of fame, but the world since the Romans has never quite seemed to esteem intellect in the way that it ought. Oh well, perhaps there's hope for the future. But I digress. Alvin and Gertie were on their way to the Bodleian Library at Oxford.
How do you know he'll be here?
I don't.
Shh! Sorry.
Gertie, before we delve too much further, do you think there is a chance that this is all just too far-fetched?
All the best things are.
But what if it's just a story, something your father left you with?
Oh, well, what good would that do?
Stories are comforting. They're meant as an escape.
Not this one.
Shh!
Sorry. You saw the map. Doesn't that prove something?
Yeah, that your father had very poor penmanship.
Shh!
Sorry.
You know, if I didn't know any better, I'd say you were trying to talk me out of
this. I'm just trying to temper your expectations.
Well, then I am so sorry.
Why?
Because people with low expectations are used to them having me let down.
Quiet! I will not apologize! This is a place of learning,
Professor Smithy!
The very one!
Who are you?
I'm Alvin Tadlock.
Who?
I was a student of yours.
Were you?
For 2 years.
Forgive me, I have so many students.
You, young lady. Look. Hey, Amelia. Do I know you?
Don't think so.
Name?
Gertie Pike, adventurer and dilettante.
You Georgian's girl! I'd recognize a Pike anywhere!
Do I look like him?
No, thank God. He showed me a picture of you once as a girl.
You recognized her from a photograph? I watered your plants.
You have an inquisitive look about you that nature tends to root out in people very quickly.
Well, I shall endeavor to remedy that.
You do nothing of the kind. It is a rare commodity.
Well, don't I look inquisitive?
No. You look as if you're apologizing for living. That is something to never do. Then people might remember you. Now, what can I do for you?
Do you have somewhere a little more private that we could talk?
If it is a necessity, we can use my office. I lead the way.
No need. I've been there before.
Yes.
In a moment, they were in the study of Professor Merton Smithy, a large room that smelled of pipe tobacco and mahogany, walls lined with maps from every location on Earth, but none that looked quite like the map that Gertie and Alvin
now lay before him.
We were hoping that you could tell us about this.
Curious. Very curious. Wait a moment. Is this what I think it is?
What do you think it is?
Does this lead to the Library of Alexandria?
Well, at least what's left of it.
My God, all that knowledge. Do we know if it is legitimate or not?
We do know it's legitimate, and my father wouldn't have left me with just a story, no matter how comforting it may be.
When your father first told me his theories, I thought he'd lost his mind. But it's real. It's all real.
Well, is there anything that you can use to help us tell more about the map?
Do you have the key? I don't see.
Well, what would a key do?
Maybe not a physical key, but a map key?
Right you are. I must have been an excellent teacher.
Good with lessons, but bad with names.
Yes, if we have the key, that would be the method to deciphering this. Otherwise, this is little more than a fish wrapper. What?
The book. Alvin, give me the book. All of the chapter headings, they're places with a symbol beneath it.
May I see?
Yes, of course. Is it something?
This is everything! And with a bit of deciphering, this will be a fish wrapper! No more! Observe!
Professor Smithy then launched into the most incredible. There, lecture on the Library of Alexandria and its location. It was brilliant. It was insightful. It was 3.5 bloody hours long. I'll summarize. The three of them determined that coordinates led to a location deep within the Valley of the Kings, all but inaccessible to the modern world.
It's all but inaccessible to the modern world.
See?
It's incredible. Absolutely incredible. I thought Duncan had lost his mind. But it's real. It's all real. The world will never be the same again. It feels like Christmas. And the captain of the pin. And I think. If you'll both excuse me, I'd like to compare this to a bit of research. Could you help me down? It's a little higher up here than I thought.
Well, that's a shame.
What?
We have to give up.
Well, who said that?
He did. We have no way of getting there.
Well, not with that attitude.
Oh, Gertie, we would need a hot air balloon or an airplane, and neither one of those things is readily available to you.
I have something similar.
Something similar to a hot air balloon or an airplane suggests that this is neither one of those things, and it is potentially very dangerous.
I will neither confirm nor deny that.
Excuse me, you can't be in here. Get out of my way!
Professor?
Shh! Unhand me, you brute! I don't want to hurt you! I shall call for the authorities!
Gunshots rang out! Bang! 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 Bang!
Take the nap and run!
We have to go!
We have to help him!
Help is coming, please!
Get up! Put me down! Don't let
me! Alan managed to carry Gertie and accept the 20 feet before having to put her down. This is in no way a commentary upon her weight, nor upon Alan's strength. It is merely the fact that has to do with trying to carry a woman who does not wish to be carried.
Don't ever do that again!
That was the same spot!
It should be noted that about the same distance, they did see to it that Merton was tended to and not seriously injured.
I'm fine!
However, do not forget that they were only 20 feet away and Keller was still lurking.
Don't get back here!
Oh God, he got away again.
He got away again?
Yes, he got the ball running.
What are the police doing?
Gertie then led Alvin to yet another safe house. It might not have been the best, but it was the closest. She led Alvin to a quaint sort of hole-in-the-wall Spanish kind of restaurant. And the owner was, well... A
never mind. I called you Gentle Giant. I could have to change all the lights. Can I get you something? Perhaps a sangria? By the way, did you know? Sangria is Spanish for sangria. Kind of like a lot of things they do.
Joao Helena, we would like to order from your secret reserve.
I don't have one of those.
Yes, yes, you do.
Oh, yes! I keep it in the back, I'll show you. Do you love me? Come, wash them out. No, with your eyeballs. Why'd you clean it? I just washed it.
Behind the bar, down the stairs, and into the cellar they went. Once again, safely underground and out of sight.
Okay, Gertie, we got you and your Gentle Giant here. What kind of trouble are you in now?
Secret trouble.
Secret? That's my favorite kind. Do you need something?
Alcohol in a bathroom in the reverse order.
Is that way.
Thank you.
What?
You'll be fine.
Now let me guess. You only drink leche.
I'm sorry?
Como se dice? Juice from the moon.
I don't understand.
Do this.
What? What is this?
Milk!
Yes!
Sometimes I have a pink's cup.
Do not mind you.
Well,
I can do that. Now, where is my shaker?
Oh, no. You don't shake a pin's cup.
You do the way I do it.
Oh, and 5, 6, 7, 8.
They call me King of a Pink. And the pink of the dust of me. When I shake my molasses, I go tick, ticky, boom, tick, ticky, boom, tick, ticky.
I feel I should apologize for this brash, over the top, vaguely Ricky Ricardo-esque stereotype. But it was the 40s. What more do you expect?
So, how'd you know my girlie?
I suppose we're friends. And we're going on an adventure.
Oh, you do have no adventure, I think, Boom Chicky Lad.
Again, really very sorry.
Well, I guess we can say that. Wait. New adventure thing?
Yes. Scooch. She came to me about a month ago and she said, Joao Helena, which is good because that is my name. She said, Joao Helena, I'm going to be an adventurer now. Would you let me use your bar as a safe house? And of course I say yes. I mean, who am I to refuse? Besides, before it was all party. It's good to see a set of rights or something.
Is that a pimp's cup?
See? There come the king of a pit! And the king of a round of it! When I take my molasses, I go tick, ticky, boom, tick, ticky, boom, tick, ticky, boom!
Joao Helena, would you mind waiting upstairs and giving Gertie and I some privacy to talk?
I guess. I mean, if that's what you want.
That is what I want, yes.
Gertie, can I get you something from the upstairs?
Oh, I would love a whiskey.
You drink like an old Irishman. God, I love that about you.
Been exactly 1 month, or 1 month and a few days.
What?
You've only been an adventurer and dilettante for a month?
Oh, so?
So? What were you before this? Some bourgeoisie party girl debutante?
That depends.
On?
What is a debutante?
A young woman from a wealthy family who flits about wasting people's time.
Oh, then yes, I'm glad. That's what I meant before. Adventurer debutante.
Oh, you cannot be serious.
Oh, you cannot be mad at me. The two words are very similar, dilettante and debutante. Ooh, both are fun to say. Dilettante, debutante.
No.
Oh, what are you so angry about?
Oh, I trusted you and I followed you because I thought you knew what you were doing. I thought you were a real adventurer.
Did you think I had a degree in it? This is one of those professions where you just declare it and you're it, you know, like writing or politics.
Oh, God, what is wrong with you?
Oh, hang on a minute.
He just got bored one day and decided to go off on a wild goose chase for the Library of Alexandria.
No, you got bored one day and decided to go on a wild goose chase for the Library of Alexandria.
Excuse me?
Yes, you got bored. standing in the middle of your boring little bookshop, in the middle of your boring little street. My God, you're tall, and I want to appeal to you on your level. You got bored. You followed me, Mr. Tanner. No one asked you to be here.
I suppose not, but...
Yes, and you do not get to make me apologize for leaving my earth because you forgot to have one of your own.
Well, your brother chased us with a gun!
He did. He did chase us with a gun, after which you had ample opportunities to leave, none of which you have taken.
Well, you made it seem so exciting!
Oh, because it is. It is exciting and new and terrifying and different.
What made you do it? What made you decide that you're terrifying, different, and exciting ways were so much better than everyone else's?
My father died.
Well, now I feel that my reaction was too harsh.
Well, it was a bit.
Well, you could have mentioned it.
Well, you were on quite a roll.
Well, I'm sorry.
No matter. He led such a big life. And the thing is, for all he did, for all he saw, he didn't go out in some blaze of glory. He just got sick, and he died. Going out with a whimper instead of a bang. The whole thing seems terribly unfair.
It is.
I'm dealing with this as I know how. And you are more than welcome to tag along, but do not blame me, and do not make me motivate you. I have enough trouble motivating myself. After all, you know, I have.
Yeah, that's right.
So, what's it to be, Mr. Tadlock? Are you going home, or are you seeing this through?
At that moment, Alvin thought back to his life before. Sunday through Monday, always the same routine, never ending, never changing. Work, 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 work.
They're seeing it through.
Are you sure? I shan't tolerate another outburst like this.
Well, someone once told me that never fear quarrels, but always seek hazardous adventures.
Alexander Dumas.
No, Dalton Pike.
Ooh, I was close. Yeah. And that was cheating. Yeah. All right. Then if we are to continue, we are to continue to Scotland.
I didn't know how much you wanted, so I didn't take you short to Holborn.
Thank you.
Well, where are you going?
Scotland.
Oh. Wait, don't you want the other bottle? Oh, well, wait, not one now. They call me human being.
And so, after a moment of self-doubt, for which I don't believe we can blame him, Alvin and Gertie, we're off to the tapped and clad terrain of Scotland. There, in a dilapidated fishing cottage at the edge of a precarious cliff, Alvin was to meet a friend of Gertie's who had something that was neither an airplane nor a hot air balloon.
How do you know this man?
Oh, I met him during the Great War.
Oh, a serviceman.
Of sorts. French Foreign Legion. After the Great War, he found he liked combat and found a way to continue.
So, friend or foe?
Depends on the day, MacDougal. It depends on the day.
Gertie Pike! Who's this?
So, that is Alvin Tadlock.
Adventurer and dilettante like yourself?
Bookworm and cautious individual.
No shame in knowing who we are. McTavish McDougal, inventor and pugilist.
No.
Pugilist. That's a good word. Pugilist. I like that.
You don't know what it means, do you?
No.
Someone who loves fights.
Oh, well used, McTavish. Well used.
Thank you. And what sort of favor is it you need today?
Oh, and what makes you think that I need a favor?
Because that's the only reason you visit. Even though you're more than welcome, I mean, I could always put out some scones or some shortbread or really some haggis even.
I know, MacDougal. I am the definition of a fellow and a friend, which is ironic, as fair weather is just the thing we'll be needing.
So you need to borrow Stuart, then?
If available.
For payment?
Oh, yes, of course. Alvin, the bottle.
What?
Whiskey.
Oh, yes. Surrounded by large, ruined pillars, and very little else.
I'll circle around! Give a shout when you need me!
Bye, MacDougall!
So this is it? Do we start digging?
I suppose so, but where?
Well, you said something earlier about a clock.
Oh, yes, the clock, the key, and where they led. My father left me the book, which happened to be the key, and he left Keller a brass pocket watch. Thought that that might be the clock, you know, something to do with the location.
Did your father know Keller's intentions?
He did.
Well, then why help him at all?
Oh, I don't know. Fairness, parental guilt, and history dictates that this has something to do with the clock.
Well, then we need to think creatively.
Oh, careful, you're liable to pull a muscle.
Well, it might have something to do with a metaphor or an allegory.
Well, I'm willing to entertain that. We are in a desert, perhaps something about the sands of time.
Or we're standing on the clock.
I'm sorry, what?
Well, look around. This is a giant sundial. And what is a sundial but a very old, very primitive clock?
Are you sure?
Trust me, I know my clocks.
Well, if this is a clock, then this is the exact center. Here, move. Okay. Help me with this. It's like an elevator shaft. Here, help me with the rope.
Alvin and Gertie descended into darkness, nearing the end of their journey. The rope was old and weather-worn, straining across an ancient piece of wood. They found themselves in a strange room, shaped like a bowl, with curious markings etched at the side.
Oh.
What's wrong?
Water. There's water coming from the wall just here.
Huh.
As Gertie jumped down onto the uneven tiled floor, she felt it shift ever so slightly.
Oh, good Lord.
What?
I think we may have a problem. Get down!
What? Gertie tackled Alvin to the floor. As blades swung from the ceiling, kicking up dirt, and dust, and sand.
I think we may have sprung a booby trap.
We?
All right, I sprung a booby trap. Crawl.
Well, how did you do that?
You see, in stories such as these, the hidden treasure is not so very often left completely unprotected. After all, how many rated pyramids does one need before you realize the need for a cutting-edge security system?
You know, we really should have expected this. The whole thing is very close.
Do you mean cliché?
I think we both know I don't know.
Well, how do we stop it?
I don't know.
Well, how did you start it?
I stepped on the tile.
Maybe a tile to start it. Maybe a tile to stop it.
I'm willing to give that a go.
Look quickly, very quickly, for a raised tile.
Scanning the floor, they found nothing that fit the bill. Then, Alvin looked up to see something that made him both very happy and very annoyed.
Oh, come on.
What?
Up there.
Way up there?
The only raised tile is up there.
Oh, well, that is terribly unfair.
Well, it's meant to keep people out. It's not meant to be fair.
I'm going to have to climb on your shoulders.
I'm going to have to get.
Do you want the blades to stop or not?
We have to get through the blades first.
Right. It'll be like a game. It'll be like hopscotch.
I don't like hopscotch.
All right, well, what do you like?
Bridge. I like bridge.
All right, then this will be just like bridge, except the blade goes, if you lose, you die.
What?
Alvin and Gertie approach the swinging blades. The blades made a terrible noise as they advanced. Foot by foot, they made their way to the tile.
Look out!
Thank you.
You're welcome. Wait. We crawled to safety to get over there. Why didn't we just crawl to safety to get over here?
Oh, that would have been easier.
Yes!
All right, well, time to climb you like redwood.
What? Wait there, just a moment.
Oh my God, that's right, you're tall!
Well, I do hunch.
Brilliant! Ooh, look at that, a lever for pulling.
You're not going to pull that, are you?
Oh, Alvin, I'm sure this has something to do with the collection.
What if it has nothing to do with the collection and we end up fighting an army of mayflies?
Oh, Alvin, don't be ridiculous. Mayflies aren't indigenous to Egypt.
Well, that's not the point. No. Well, that was easier than I expected.
We have a lot of loose ends to wrap up, and only about 10 minutes left in the space, so do forgive. In the dim light that streamed in from above, they could barely make out the shapely outlines of an ancient chest.
Oh, Alvin, this has to be it.
Do you think it is?
I do. Oh, I'm a tear, it's all!
more exciting than work, more intense even than his connection to books. For the first time in his life, Alvin felt the sheer, unadulterated joy of discovery.
Back away, Jack!
Oh, how did you even get here?
I know a French can-can dancer with a hot air balloon.
I'm sorry, what?
You're not the only one with broad, stereotypical friends. Now look, I can be reasonable. I can. Just bring the collection back with me and we'll split the profits.
That is not what Father wanted.
And you always do everything he wanted.
Yes.
So he wanted you to date both Howard twins for an entire summer.
Firstly, he did not know about that. Secondly, I will not apologize. That was a cracking summer.
Look, I need this girl.
It is not my fault that you squandered your entire inheritance.
Look, you cannot sell knowledge to the highest bidder.
Who is this?
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm Alvin Tatlock.
Oh, pleasure. Yes, yes.
In stories such as these, the villain can often be persuaded to find a heart at the last moment.
Look, this is ridiculous. You two are family. Just put aside your differences and maybe we
can... Bang! Oh, God!
Alvin!
This is not one of those stories, and Keller is not a man looking for redemption. As Alvin writhed in pain, Keller seized the precious collection, ran to the elevator, and began his escape upwards. Then, with a mighty roar, the whole of the ancient elevator was aflame, seemingly out of nowhere. However, do not forget that at this moment it contained a very literal smoking gun. A hot spark had touched the ancient rope and dilapidated wood. And in a moment, the whole of the elevator collapsed with a mighty roar, and Keller was gone. Ironically, so was the collection, lost in the same way as its compatriots so many years ago.
No!
Which brings us to the bottom of the ruins, where all now seemed lost. Smoke was beginning to fill the ancient cavern, blocking out the sky, and Dougal was nowhere to be seen. The end now seemed all but inevitable for Alvin and Gertie.
Alvin! Alvin, are you all right?
Oh, well, I'm not dead.
Oh, please do keep it that way. Field medicine is really not in my purview.
Well, it's just my arm, but it's just as much as I thought it was.
I am so sorry. I dragged you into this. I brought you here. I brought you here, and now we've lost the collection. Oh, my God! Oh, my God, we've lost the collection! That was the one thing we shouldn't have done!
Gertie.
Oh, God, if we're going to die down here. Now we're going to die down here. We're going to die down here, just like my brother died down here. Oh, my God, my brother's dead.
Well,
oh, that's not.
To be fair, your brother did try and kill us a lot.
Oh, God.
For the first time since living here, Alvin saw the adventurer and dilettante stroke debutante giving up. Not as sure, not as confident. Not Gertie.
Gertie.
Oh my God, this is why people do it.